राकेश प्लीज स्टार्ट प्रेजेंटिंग।
सुमन 47 इयर्स ओल्ड लेडी ऑक्यूपेशन ऑफ होम मेकर रेजिडेंट ऑफ दिल्ली केम टू सर्जिकल ओपीडी विथ चीफ कंप्लेंट्स ऑफ स्वेलिंग इन लेफ्ट अपर पार्ट ऑफ नेक बिलो मैंडिबल फॉर 2 इयर्स। पेशेंट वॉज अपेरेंटली वेल 2 इयर्स बैक एंड देन शी नोटिस स्वेलिंग इन द लेफ्ट अपर पार्ट ऑफ नेक बिलो मैंडिबल। स्वेलिंग इज इंसीडियस ऑनसेट 2 इयर्स ड्यूरेशन एंड ग्रेजुअली प्रोग्रेस्ड फ्रॉम साइज ऑफ अबाउट 2 into 2 centimeters टू प्रेजेंट साइज ऑफ about 4 into 3 centimeters. Swelling is not associated with redness or pain during food intake. No history of change in size or swelling after meal. No history of pain and redness over the swelling. No history of first discharge in the floor of the mouth. There is no history of toothache or sensitivity to cold and warm substances, gingivitis, tonsillitis, ear and tongue problems. No history of recent rapid increase in size or swelling or skin changes over the swelling. There is no history of dryness of mouth and eyes. No history of other swellings in the neck, upper region and also parotid region. Coming to past history, there is no history of similar complaints in the past and the patient is a known case of hypertension from 3 years and she is on irregular medication. The patient is a not known case of diabetes, bronchial asthma and tuberculosis. Family history not significant and there is no cancellated deaths in family members. And personal history. Patient is on vegetarian diet and normal appetite. Our bowel bladder movements are regular. No history of tobacco intake and there is no history of substance abuse. And drug allergy. It is not significant. There is no drug allergy and there is no history of previous surgeries. Coming to COVID-19 history, there is no history of recent contact, symptoms and COVID-related deaths in family members. Menstrual history, regular cycles and the last LMP is 12th of this month. And obstetric history is para 2, live 2. In coming to summary of my history, 47 years old lady with swelling in left submandibular region of size approximately 4 into 3 centimeters from 2 years with gradually progressive in nature and it is not associated with pain, redness or changes during or after the meal. There is no history of recent rapid increase in size of swelling and there is no involvement of the skin above the swelling. There is no complaints of oral cavity, ear or no other swellings in opposite side and the neck. The patient is a known case of hypertension and there is no normal, no significant family history and it's and our personal history is normal. Hello. Hello. Sir, can I answer?
You are saying that 47 years old female. Is that the correct thing that you are saying?
47 years lady.
47 years can never be old, Joy, na?
Sorry, sir. 47 years lady, sir.
And then you are telling exactly, Joy, that it was 2 by 2 centimeters, which progressed to 4 by 3 centimeters.
Sir, it is she, when she given history to me 2 years back, she told almost 2 into 2, sir. But she didn't say exactly size.
No, you know, history is in the always in the patient's language. No? So you can say your history. Like if you just say it is 2 centimeters in size, we will accept. But if you say 2 centimeters by 2 centimeters, then it will be difficult to accept. No, similarly, 4 by 3, 4 centimeter, it is acceptable. No?
Okay,
but
sir.
Not 4 by 3 centimeters.
Okay, sir.
And the patient will not see the mandible, Joy. No? What she will say?
It is left submandibular, left upper left swelling below the mandible, sir.
No, she upper will left not.
Part of the neck.
She doesn't know the mandible, Joy. No? Does she know mandible? What is mandible? So what she will say?
Jaw, sir.
Yeah, below the jaw, you know. Yeah, lower jaw. You
know? Lower jaw.
Yeah. Try to fit all these things as far as possible. You know, it is not always necessary, but as far as possible, it should be fitted in the patient's language. You know?
Okay, sir. Below jaw. Neck. Left upper part of neck, below jaw.
Right. That's right. Yeah. Okay.
Rakesh, just hold on. Apart from this spelling as a complaint. Does she have any other complaints?
No, sir. She didn't have any complaints of pain, or she didn't have any complaint. She has history of toothache, that too 4 to 5 years back, sir.
So obviously, like the first case, my question to you is again, when this patient has come to your OPD and showing you something is there since 2 years. 2 years, and this is what is the absolutely no other complaints. What are the things come into your mind first? Same questions like the first case.
Chronic inflammatory pathology, sir.
Why did you use the word chronic inflammatory to begin with? Absolutely no pain at all for this patient. No fever, nothing. How did you say chronic inflammation? What do you mean by chronic inflammation? Which condition you are suspecting?
If chronic, sir, you know, at night is, if it is more than 2 years.
I'm not right. It is not possible. Obviously, we are discussing submandibular salivary gland only. My question to you is the same question like before. You are considering, number one, benign pathology. It should be there.
Yes, sir. Benign swelling.
Again, I come back to the same questions like, is it a lymph nodal swelling, or is it a submandibular swelling, or is it something else? Even sometimes subcutaneous lipoma patients have told, I have got some swelling here. So don't take it for granted that everything is the same. This is our history. We are in the because that nothing, no pain, no redness, no skin, nothing is there. No other point to say it could be sialadenitis. What is the typical presentation of sialadenitis?
Chronic pain during chewing, sir.
Chronic pain? What do you mean by chronic pain? What did you understand that word chronic here?
The pain during chewing that is present for more than 4 to 5 months.
Is it the common complaint or anything else? When there is a stone which is blocking, so what will happen to the gland?
Can be blocked, sir.
What happened? What patient will tell you? Suppose you keep the lime in the oral cavity. What will happen?
Sensitivity to the increase in pain sensitivity.
Size of the gland increases. Typical, right? Okay. Size of the gland. We discussed this in the first clinics, no? It's a more of a thick secretions, non-dependent duct. Lingual nerve is causing a bit of kinking of the duct. All these points we are told. So what is important here is, yes, pain, number one. Yeah. Number two, increase in the size of the
swelling.
Any other questions you have asked apart from this swelling? I am seeing all the negative things here, no problem. So you want to rule out any infection, etc. Anything else?
I asked about any problems in oral cavity, sir.
Yeah. Can you tell me the sites in oral cavity which are drained to, say, submandibular lymph node?
From the base of the mouth, sir, and gingiva and buccal mucosa.
And so you would like to rule out any focus, rather, maybe benign or whatever, malignancy, etc. But so nothing in the oral cavity, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Again, the question is a 47-year-old lady. Did you ask history of any joint pain? You need to ask. As I mentioned to you, submandibular gland, the autoimmune, one of the important diagnoses of autoimmune is the sialadenitis is autoimmune pathology. Okay?
Okay, sir. There is no problem.
Sir, Karunakaran, sir, anything, sir, from your side?
Sir, you are in mute mode, sir.
Let me ask later, sir. Is it audible?
Yes.
So in one of your slides, you said pain referred to the ear. Can you go back to that slide?
No, sir, it is in, she didn't complain of pain, sir. Pain, sir.
No pain at all, sir.
No, it's pain, a painless swelling from the 2 years, sir.
So no radiating pain to the ear.
Yes, sir.
Yes, just go ahead. Go.
So in the absence of the pain, would you like to consider a calculus disease or a tumor of the submandibular gland?
Well, tumor of the submandibular gland, sir. Whether it's a calculus, it always it irritates and it causes pain, sir. One or another episode, there will be pain.
So you'd like to keep, because of this 2 years duration, tumor means you are considered benign only again?
Yes, sir. Benign only, sir. And also some features like there is no recent rapid increase in size or swelling. And also...
Is the submandibular gland benign tumors like pleomorphic is common?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
In submandibular gland, 50% tumors are benign, 50% are malignant, sir. Out of 50%, mostly 80 to 90% are pleomorphic tumors, sir.
And what I wanted is the incidence of malignancy increases as you go from
major cerebral gland to minor cerebral gland tumor, sir.
Correct. So that you always keep it in mind. Okay. All right.
Yes. Yes, sir.
You can go ahead.
So on general examination, after introducing myself to the patient and taking consent, patient was examined in a well-ventilated room in presence of a female chaperone. Patient is conscious and oriented to time, place and person. Patient was moderately built and well-nourished. Karnofsky performance score is 90. No signs of pallor, ichthus, cyanosis, clubbing and no generalized lymphadenopathy. And vitals, patient is afebrile and her BP is 130-70 millimeters of mercury on left arm sitting position near radioradial or radiofemoral delay. Our pulsate is 83 per minute, regular rate, rhythm and volume, and our respiratory rate is 13 per minute, thoracoabdominal type. And compared to regional examination, upper facial symmetry is normal with fullness in the left submandibular triangle. Right submandibular region is normal. Left submandibular region swelling of size approximately 4 into 3 centimeters, which is oval in shape, smooth surface with diffuse margins. Skin overlying the swelling is normal, with no cuff impulse or pulsation seen. No other swellings in the neck. Come to oral cavity examination. On inspection, dentition is normal with missing of the right molar tooth. Oral cavity hygienity maintained. Tonsillar fossa normal, tongue is normal, and cheek, gums, and retromolar trigone are normal. No pus discharge from the floor of the oral cavity. And on palpation, there is no local rise of temperature over the swelling. It is a non-tender swelling of size 4 into 3 centimeters in the submandibular triangle on the left side, which is foam consistency, well-defined margins, lobulated surface, not fixed to underlying skin, and bilateral frenulum is normal. It is non-compressible, non-pulsatile, non-transilluminating, and no palpable thrill. And on oral cavity palpation, bidigital palpation shows enlarged left submandibular gland. And duct opening is normal, no stone palpable in the duct, no other swellings in the floor of the mouth, no other swellings palpable in the neck region. Examination of another other salivary glands are normal, no bruise heard over the swelling, and other systemic examination is essentially normal, like neck and also cervical spine. And coming to case summary, 47 years lady with 2 years history of solitary swelling in left submandibular gland of size 4 into 3 centimeters, which is gradually progressive in nature with a smooth surface and normal skin over the swelling. No changes associated with food intake and there is no features of inflammation and malignancy. So painless swelling with foam consistency, which is bidigitally palpable with no stone palpable in the duct. And oral cavity examination is essentially normal and neck examination is normal. So my provisional diagnosis, 47 years lady with benign tumor of left submandibular gland, most probably mixed submandibular adenoma, It can be pleomorphic adenoma, sir.
My question is tumors common in submandibular? Okay, I think we'll go to the clinical examination probably later, come back to the diagnosis. Yeah, just show me that regional examination you have mentioned. Please remember, it's not that you should not comment upon facial symmetry. What is your area of interest in this patient?
Submandibular region, sir, right and left.
Just because we mentioned facial asymmetry for the parotid, it's fine. But when this patient is given to you, say you start from the locoregional mean. First is the neck, okay? First is the neck. You start comment on the neck here. That swelling, whatever you have written there, right? Submandibular region is normal. So first, as you start inspecting. Explain the size, shape, surface, border, and all that thing which you are given there. Skin is normal. Why did you mention cough impulse?
Sometimes the swelling, it can be attached to intraoral.
What? What is that? Intraoral. I don't get into trouble for this. You are talking about the submandibular salivary gland and you are telling no cough impulse. So you don't get that. Okay.
Okay, sir.
You know, the cough, to have a cough impulse, you need to have some communication either with the trachea, thoracic cavity, spinal cavity, abdominal cavity. So what I'm trying to tell is hernia, meningocele, all like that. You should have some communication. So otherwise you won't get that. Okay.
Okay,
don't get into trouble there. So, why pulsations?
It can be dilated veins or dilated arteries over the swelling.
Hold on. Why pulsation? I asked you. Started telling dilated veins. What is this veins? Veins are pulsatile?
No, sir. Arteries. Sorry.
We'll ask.
External carotid.
One minute. Which condition veins can be pulsatile? This is how
fistula, sir. When there is connection between artery and veins.
So why my question? So what we are interested to know is, I know this little is a submandibular. If it is real anterior triangle carotid body tumor, that can come somewhere there, not in the submandibular, but little laterally.
Yes.
So you just keep it in mind. Smooth surface. According diffuse margin, and no cough impulse not required. No other spirits. Sir, please take over.
Sir. Continuing with the cough impulse, tell which swelling can give the cough impulse in the neck.
Yes.
Laryngocele, sir. Which attached to the larynx.
Which swelling can give the cough impulse in the chest?
Dual cavity.
What is that swelling?
See how you will be in trouble now. So, yes.
But probably he is confusing with plunging ranula, sir.
I got the point, sir, but he should not mention for this. Not here.
You know empyema necessitans?
Yes, sir.
So there you can get a cough impulse in the chest. Okay, apart from in the skull or in the back. Hernias, all type of hernias, and they will give the cough impulse. Okay. Now, at one place, you have written underlying skin. What is that?
Sir,
where
sir,
the skin can be underlying?
Overlying skin, sir. That is grammatical.
Yeah, but I think you have written the underlying skin there. And then you have written somewhere the bilateral frenulum. Okay, in this slide. What is that bilateral frenulum?
It on the base of the mouth. Frenulal opening.
So there are two frenula?
No, sir. One single frenulum, sir. And bilateral side of the frenulum is normal. Either sides of the frenulum is normal.
No, frenulum is only one, isn't it? That's in the center, just underneath the tongue.
Yes, sir. So either sides of the frenulum is normal, sir.
Will you say that bilateral frenulum there?
No, sir.
What
no,
you will
sir.
Say? No, you will not say one. That.
Yes, sir. And either sides of the frenulum is normal. bilateral.
How do you differentiate between a submandibular gland and a submandibular lymph node?
Sir, submandibular gland is bidistally palpable, sir, with deep lobe, and submandibular lymph node is not bidistally palpable, sir. So I can differentiate between both, sir.
Where is the opening of the submandibular gland?
Submandibular gland is open at the floor of the mouth at the lingual papillae, sir, on either sides of the frenulum, sir.
You know how many minor salivary glands are there in the oral cavity?
Sir, almost 450, sir. 450 minor salivary glands are present in oral cavity, sir.
And if a tumor arises from that?
It can be malignant, sir. We would suspect first malignancy. Then, unless until proved otherwise, any swelling other arise from the minor salivary glands, it most probably malignancy, sir.
What is the commonest swelling which can arise from the minor salivary gland?
That is retention cyst, sir. Granula. Extravasation cyst, sir. Granula.
The ranula is not so common. Any other cyst which is there, which you frequently see in the lower lip chair?
Mucus cyst, sir. Mucus retention cyst.
Mucus retention cyst. That is the commonest swelling which can rise in the minor salivary glands.
It's a mucus retention cyst.
Okay.
Rakesh.
Yes, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Sorry. If the submandibular gland is lateral, the swelling is so lateral, it looks like a parotid gland. How can you anatomically say it is a parotid or a submandibular? What based is the structure?
So based on the side surface,
that's a parotid.
So parotid is present in parotid region, sir, and submandibular in the submandibular triangle, sir. And also the
what is the structure? That separates parotid from submandibular gland.
Sir, mandible, sir. Angle of mandible. If it is present above the angle of mandible, it can be parotid, sir. It is rising the recto ear lobule. If it is present below the mandible, it can be submandibular gland, sir.
See, there is one thing called stylomandibular ligament. The stylomandibular ligament separates the parotid from the submandibular gland. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
Sir. So should I say again? Hello.
If this gland is hard in consistency, 2 years duration, what do you suspect, Rakesh?
Sir, I will suspect adenosis. It's malignant feature, malignant swelling, sir.
I have given you 2 years duration time. Small gland like this only. What do you suspect?
So that malignant tumor, that too,
Please remember, you can get a big stone inside the gland itself there. Okay, right? So,
yes,
so it is not what it would feel sometimes as a hard tumor can be a stone, large stone. That's what is the clue to you. If it is a 2 years duration, you suspect a calculus stone. Disease. It's possible that it could be hard. All right, go ahead. Like, okay. What? Differential diagnosis?
My differential diagnosis is soital lymph node. It can be soital lymph nodes. But on bidistal palpation.
Yeah, but that has been already solved out because the no lymph node will be bidigitally palpable. That is ruled out. So one is you are suspecting the tumors of the parotid gland. Second should be chronic sialadenitis. Chronic sialadenitis. Okay, you can always give a differential diagnosis, second diagnosis when they ask you. These are the two swellings which you are popular from the submandibular gland. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Stones are more common in the parotids or in the submandibular?
Sir, stones are more common in submandibular gland when compared to parotids, sir, because of its secretion. It is viscous secretion, sir, highly viscous fluid, and also anti-gravity position of the gland and also duct, sir, and also high calcium content in the secretion, sir. So that stones are more common.
Which gland produces the maximum saliva?
Parotid gland, sir.
Hmm?
Parotid gland, sir. Serous part is mostly produced by the parotid gland.
Parotid doesn't produce the maximum saliva. If you look all the glands, which produce the maximum saliva? Submandibular gland. Submandibular gland produces the maximum saliva. Okay, then is the parotid. Okay, then is the sublingual and the minor salivary glands which are there.
Okay, sir.
Rakesh, why is the submandibular gland is bidigitally palpable?
Because the deep lobe is present above the myohyoid muscle, sir. So that if the deep lobe, it can be present in the floor of the mouth.
There are two parts. That's what you have to say, superficial and the deep lobe. So again, the deep lobe is, that's what you are trying to say, above means actually deep there. So that is felt in the oral cavity. And the duct again arises from the deep lobe of the submandibular cerebellum. Okay.
Right.
Sir, can we go to the management, sir?
Yes.
Sir.
Go ahead. What do you want to do?
Sir, I will do investigation to confirm my diagnosis and treat the patient, sir. First, for investigation, I will go for ultrasound of the neck. And also, then if it in ultrasound, it shows any malignant features, or I will go for CT scan, sir. If the in ultrasound, if the swelling doesn't show any malignant features, then I will go for ultrasound guided FNAC of the swelling, sir.
What type of the tumor you expect in this patient?
It can be benign tumors, that to pleomorphic adenoma, sir.
Okay. Is the chance more of malignancy here as compared to the parotid or less of the parotid?
Yes, sir. There are in parotid mostly 70-80% are benign and 20-30% are malignant, sir. In submandibular, almost 50-60% are benign and 40-50% are malignant, sir. And when you compare to then sublingual, mostly 90% are minus or 90% are malignant, sir. So most chance of malignancy is present in submandibular gland when compared to parotid gland, sir.
Smaller the gland, more is the chance of the malignancy.
Malignancy. Yes, sir.
So you have done your investigations. It comes out to be a case of pleomorphic adenoma.
Yes, sir.
So what is your plan now?
Plan is submandibular gland excision, sir.
What are the various important nerves which come in your field when you are doing the surgery for the submandibular gland?
From based on the incision, first our incision should be 3-4 centimeters below the mandible, sir, so that to preserve the marginal, to prevent the injury to marginal mandibular nerve. When you go into the deep from superficial, then first lingual nerve, sir, we have to preserve with submandibular ganglion. Then at the base of the submandibular gland, there will be hypoglossal nerve, sir. So three nerves we have to be careful during surgery of submandibular gland, sir.
And which important vessels comes in that?
Yes, sir. There are two vessels. First, anterior facial vein and also the facial artery, sir. Mm-hmm. And there is a various course of facial artery in submandibular gland. Sometimes it can be passed through the gland, and it can be present in the superior of the gland. So we have to be cautious of facial arteries.
So how many times you have to ligate the facial artery when you are doing the surgery for the submandibular gland?
Sir, we have to ligate twice facial artery during submandibular gland, sir.
At least twice, no?
Yes, sir, at least because twice, sir.
There may be so much, even more than that also. But at least twice has to be ligated.
Okay, sir.
What precaution you take when you are making the incision for the submandibular gland?
It is mostly 3-4 centimeters below the inferior margin of the mandible, sir.
How will you raise the flap here?
here my flap should be raised in subplatysmal plane, sir, as you told that to prevent damage to the marginal mandible nerve. It is above the platysmus muscle.
Right. So are you going to remove a complete submandibular or only the superficial one?
No, sir. Complete, sir. I'll just remove complete so submandibular.
How will you go to the deep low?
Sir, it is present posterior and to myohyoid muscle. So we have to go retract the myohyoid muscle to anterior so that you can see the deep low.
Posterior to the myohyoid?
Posterior to myohyoid.
Or superficial to the myohyoid?
Superficial to myohyoid, sir.
Because you have to retract the, yeah, you have to retract only, yeah, then only you will reach to the deep lobe.
Yes, sir.
Now, what you will do to the submandibular duct?
Submandibular duct, sir, we have to ligate as distal as possible, sir.
Now, in case if you are dealing with a case of a sialoadenitis with the stones,
yes, sir,
then what you have to do?
The management depends upon size of the stones and site of the stone, sir. For size, it is less than 4 mm. We can go with Dormier, some stone extractor, as a Dormier. And from it is where? More than,
from where?
From the intraoral, sir. Based on the site also, sir. Site.
Right. Mm-hmm.
If it is more than 4 mm and site, sir, if it is proximal or distal to the lingual nerve.
Right.
If it is distal to lingual nerve, we can go intraoral approach. And also, we can access the duct and remove the stone. And we can leave that gland duct, sir. If it is distal to,
Do you excise the duct or incise the duct?
Inside
the duct. Intraorally. Yeah, you inside, never excise that. You only incise it. No?
Okay, sir.
Do you suture that or not?
We suture to surrounding flap, sir, so that saliva will be oozed outside. Surrounding
sutures. If you suture that, what can happen?
Stitches will form, sir, so it will block further secretion. So we have to just approximate to surrounding.
What is that called as surrounding means? To
marsupialization.
So something like that you have to do. Depends upon how much is that stone is there, or you know, extract the stones, incise it, pus will come out, and if you are having a free flow of the salivary gland contents, then you do that, something like that, marsupialization. Otherwise, most of the time, if it is a already chronically felt gland there, it's better to excise. No? That is what it is. My question to you is, how do you identify hypoglossal nerve at surgery? And where exactly you do that?
It is at the base of the submandibular bed, sir. Bed of submandibular fossa.
You say base means, okay.
After the excision of the gland.
After excision of the gland. You might have cut also then. So
I don't.
What is the lower limit of the salivary gland, submandibular gland? Lower limit. Like what is the triangle? Submandibular triangle is bounded by below what?
Two bellies of digastric muscle and also mandible, sir.
Two bellies of digastric, and in between there is something else.
Myelo.
No. In between means intermediate tendon of digastric belly. Okay. Intermediate tendon. You have a Langhan forceps? Langhan back forceps.
Yes.
You can hook that. You know, the Langhan back you retract and hold the gland and lift it up. With the peanut you start mobilizing. Posterolaterally, first you get the facial artery. Posterolaterally. Once you are ligated, the facial artery, it will be obviously a pulsatile structure. As moving out, what you told me as the base, as I understand, is the actually floor. Floor means somewhere in the deeper. There you find a hypoglossal nerve. My question to you was, how do you identify the beautiful two vena comitant, blue structures? You know what I mean by vena comitant is? They are the blue veins.
It's the veins surrounding the nose. Like it's saphenous nerve, we can...
Exactly. So you will see that hypoglossal nerve, these are one or two landmarks. You retract the tendon, shift the gland up with your whatever forceps, and then ligate the facial artery. Then you will be able to do that. Then you come medially, And then again, as it is entering into the face, facial artery, you know, over the mandible, there. Also, you need to ligate it. That is the important one step you should know during the excision, other than preserving the lingual nerve. That easy to damage also. Anyway, I wanted the marginal mandible that you already mentioned. So that is what the three incisions to give directly over the swelling and remove. Right. Sir, any questions, sir? Karunakaran, sir.
Sir, let me have, sir. So is how close you can go dissect the lingual nerve? Is it coming close to the submandibular gland or not? Which portion of the gland is close to the lingual nerve?
The duct of the gland is very close to the lingual nerve, sir. It hooks around the ducts of the submandibular gland.
The duct is in the deep lobe or superficial lobe?
The duct is near to deep lobe, sir. It arises from the deep lobe.
See, when you get hold of the deep lobe and just pull it down, you may have a V-shaped lingual nerve. See, you may track. I mean, the lingual nerve may be pulled down like a V. Correct. You should dissect as meticulous as possible without injuring the lingual nerve. At the same time, the duct is also close to that. So we should ligate the duct at that place. So these two important points, we have to keep it in mind when you do dissection of the deeper lobe of the submandibular gland. Otherwise, you may injure a lingual nerve or you may injure the duct without ligating it properly. Okay. Yes. And as sir said, see, it is bounded by the anterior and posterior belly of the digastric. It is within the submandibular triangle. The gland is within the submandibular triangle. Already I said that the hypoglossal nerve passes through which? It comes from which canal? See, hypoglossal nerve is the 12th nerve or 11th nerve?
12th, sir. Spinal
accessory
is
11th. Spinal accessory and vagus and what is the 9th nerve? Glossopharyngeal. These three nerves come from which foramen?
Jugular
foramen. The hypoglossal nerve also comes from the same foramen or a different foramen?
Different foramen, sir. Vagus nerve along with they all comes from the jugular foramen.
Jugular foramen, whereas hypoglossal nerve comes through
hypoglossal canal.
Okay, yes, and it's bit lateral, as I said. By the time of ligating the facial artery, you may come across the hypoglossal nerve. Okay,
sir.
Okay, so what is the significance of hypoglossal nerve?
Hypoglossal nerves, it is mostly motor branches to the tongue, sir, same side. If it is damaged, the tongue is deviated to the same side.
Okay.
Motor branches of all intrinsic muscles of the tongue, sir.
What is the significance of lingual nerve?
Lingual nerve, it is transmit both sensation, that is normal first to lingual nerve, anterior to third of the tongue, general sensation, sir. And it also has some facial caudate tympanic nerve branches. It will transmit stage sensation from the anterior to third of the tongue, sir. It has both. It has fifth nerve sensory.
Taste sensation.
Sir, normal and sensation from the anterior to third of the tongue, sir. Normal, sir, like pain.
General sensation. Sensation by which now?
General sensation by the.
Anterior two-third of the tongue. Anterior two-third of the tongue.
Taste sensation from the caudate tympanic branch of the facial nerve, sir.
Yeah.
And these nerves also will travel to lingual nerves.
When there is a pain radiating from the mandible to the ear, what is the significance of that?
Involvement of pain. Radiating friend.
See, the patient has got a lesion in the oral cavity somewhere near the lateral aspect of the floor of the mouth that produces pain radiating to the ipsilateral ear. What is the significance?
Blockage of eustachian or radiating pain to the.
Is there any relation between the lingual? Is there any relation between the lingual nerve for that?
I don't know, sir.
See, when there is an infiltration or infiltration of the lingual nerve, that may produce radiating pain to the ipsilateral ear. Why? Though it is not concerned with the submandibular gland. So we are talking about the lingual nerve. That is why I am asking this question.
Posterior auricular nerve.
Posterior auricular. You don't know. The auriculotemporal nerve and this lingual nerve share the same nerve root. Hence, once the lingual nerve gets stimulated or irritated, we may have a referred pain to the ipsilateral ear. Am I right or wrong?
Rakesh, read a little more about trigem. What are those actually? They are branches of trigeminal nerve, no? Trigeminal gives mandibular nerve. Mandibular gives anterior and posterior branch. Anterior one gives that lingual nerve. Posterior also further divides. There it gives the otic ganglion, tympanic membrane and all that thing. So if you, that is what sir is trying to ask you. You know, a little bit of anatomy, please go and read brush up because this is a definite question. Most of the oral cavity lesions, they hold like this, you know, auriculotic, like pain like this. So, like in the parotid gland, fasciovenous plane and that retromandibular vein anatomy, retromandibular vein formation of that. And here, this question just now asked you.
Auriculotemporal nerve.
Both are branches of the trigeminal nerve. Mandibular actually. Division anterior to posterior.
V3.
Sir, shall we call it a day, sir, today? Sir, it is 12:10:23. Kanakaviru, sir. Or Ajay Khanna, sir, remarks and
your voice.
I think we already had it 2.5 hours of the salivary neoplasm.
We need to.
Let us call it a day.
I think so. So unless Rakesh, you have any question, Kanakvelus, I think can band. I think width is also. Rakesh, any questions are there from your side?
No, sir. But I am very pleased. I am very thankful to all the examiners or mentors, sir, for correcting every part, sir.
The mandibular gland. The two common pathologies. One is a stone disease. Another is the tumor. But again, I'll tell you, tumor is not, I should not call it as common, but remember stone. If you rule out a stone disease, then next will be the submandibular tumor only. But don't forget lymph node, because that is next possibility. Lymph node. Again, when it comes to lymph node, same question. Is it tuberculosis? Is it metastasis? Is it lymphoma? Same way. So, 2 years duration, metastasis, unlikely. Tuberculosis, no.
No signs of stigmata of TB.
I'm just trying to give you how the case. This is a short case for you. How to answer in the exam. If they ask you lymph node, get ready for those 2-3 diagnoses. Again, isolated submandibular node in a Hodgkin's is almost unheard. So that could be submental, submandibular, preauricular, postauricular chain. That's what
outer ring of the world here.
Non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. So like that. So, and if it is a tumor, excision. And here, definitely they will ask you the steps and basic anatomy. That's all from my side, sir.
Comment.